What's up, everybody, and welcome to another edition of AGR's Pop Culture Reviews. So a couple of you have emailed me and asked me if I can do a spoiler talk on the season 4 of Orange is the New Black. Now, normally I like to stay away from spoiler talks, and the reason is that I don't want to inadvertently spoil something for somebody who hasn't seen the show. But given how heavy season 4 was, I think it actually merits one. I also really take it seriously when fans give me feedback on the show, and I like to give them what they want, especially those who take the time to email me or leave comments in the comments section. Now, before I begin, I just want to give a special shout out to Alice Condado for really being the inspiration of this episode. Thanks for the feedback, Alice, and this one's for you. So obviously, this edition is going to be very heavy on spoilers, so I like to use the 5-second rule. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. If you're spoiled now, it's your own fault. Alright guys, go get some soda, go get some popcorn, or get a stiff drink, because we're really going to get into season 4 now. So there's so much to talk about, I'm not going to be able to get to everything, but I am going to talk about the major plot points that happen this season. Okay, first I gotta start with Crazy Eyes and how she came to be incarcerated, because it really pissed me the hell off. Now, we all know the character, and she's a bit of an enigma. Mostly because she is actually really intelligent, but a bit of a savant. She has a very unique way at looking at the world, almost childlike, and unfortunately that worked against her here. By all accounts, on the outside, she was a well-adjusted individual. She held down a job at what looks like could be a Walmart, or a Target, or something like that. And she greeted people, and they loved her. As a matter of fact, when we see her backstory, she's actually presented with an award for Best Employee. Part of that story included a relationship that she had with, it looks like, a soccer mom who used to come to the store a lot, and she befriended her son, in a very childlike way. The catalyst for her imprisonment really came when the caregivers that she was staying with told her that they were going on vacation. Now you can tell she is obviously upset and really nervous about this, as she's never really been alone before. Unfortunately, her caregivers just brushed it off, and they told her that they saw it as an opportunity for her to make new friends. In a really screwed up twist of fate, Crazy Eyes decides to go to the park, and when she gets to the park, she runs into the same boy that she befriended in the store, and had played with several times. Very innocently, she asks the little boy if he likes ice cream. When he says yes, they both agree to go back to her place to have ice cream. After playing video games for several hours, the little boy wants to go home, and she asks him to stay. He kind of freaks out, calls 911, she freaks out because, as you know, she looks at things like a child, and she thinks that you should only call 911 in an emergency. The little boy goes out onto the fire escape, and she tries to go after him because she knows how dangerous it is to be out there. He stammers, she tries to grab him, and he eventually plummets to his death. If that's not shitty enough, on top of that, she gets accused of not only child endangerment and kidnapping, but also the murder of a child. And there you have it, folks. That's how Crazy Eyes ended up in prison. Now, I'm not ashamed to say this. This is one of many times where I had to pause Netflix and say, what the fuck, man? So, Lolly and Alex, I really have to lump these two together, as their stories are intertwined in a very interesting way. As you recall, at the end of season 3, Alex was being assaulted in the greenhouse by an assassin. Just before her former employee's assassin was able to finish the job, Lolly comes in and kicks the shit out of this guy. What makes this storyline so brilliant is the juxtaposition of the two characters. Ever since season 3, both of these two characters have been extremely paranoid that people were out to get them and even out to kill them. As it turns out, the paranoia wasn't just in Alex's head, and it's almost poetic justice how it was Lolly that was the one that actually saved her. As it turns out, Lolly was actually an investigative journalist on the outside who kind of crashed and burned. Having lost everything that she owned, she eventually became homeless and ultimately succumbed to the voices in her head. Prior to being incarcerated, she spent most of her time harmlessly selling coffee on the street. That is, of course, until she ran into two of the stupidest cops I've ever seen. If these two imbeciles hadn't overreacted, if they had educated themselves, read a pamphlet, hell, gone to a learning annex on how to spot mental health issues, this entire incident could have been avoided, and I can only imagine how many times in real life this kind of shit has happened. Now here's the screwed up thing, even though Lolly had given a vicious beating to that assassin, he actually didn't die of his wounds. It was only after Alex decided to sneak back into the greenhouse to check on the body that she realized he was still alive and she ended up suffocating him. So technically, it was Alex who actually killed the assassin. Finally, with a little help from the gardener slash biker lady, I can't remember her name right now, they decide to chop up the body and bury the parts underneath the garden. Now, at this point, there's only four characters that really know what's making the soil so fertile this season, if you know what I mean. Because of Lolly's condition, Red, Alex, and the biker lady, who again, I don't know what her name is right now, are debating on whether or not they should kill Lolly because she has a tendency to run at the mouth. Of course, Alex is really opposed to this idea, as Lolly really did save her life, so she decides instead to make it seem like nothing ever happened, or that it was all just in Lolly's head. Now, if you recall from my review, I mentioned that a lot of the conflicts that happened this season is a direct result of the corporatization taking over the prison. Due to an engineering snafu, and in the hopes of increasing the inmate population to, of course, increase quarterly earnings for the corporation, they end up unearthing the body. Now, before Red and the others can actually execute their plan, Lolly has already confessed to Healy that she's killed somebody and buried him in the garden, although he doesn't initially believe her. And this segues amazingly into what I think is some of the most brilliant character development, especially when it comes to Healy. Now, we all know Healy has been struggling with something internally for some time now, and it wasn't just a coincidence that he's very socially awkward. As it turns out, there's a reason that Healy gravitates to Lolly, and it has to do with the fact that his own mother struggled with mental illness and homelessness. Because of this, Healy takes a much more vested interest in her, and even indulges some of her fantasies, including building a time machine from cardboard and tinfoil. But the fantasy can only last so long, and after they unearth the body due to the construction, Healy finally comes to the realization that this actually happened, even though technically Lolly didn't do it. Now at the time, Healy's emotional state is very volatile. Ironically, due to a program that was actually successful and was ripped away from him. Because he was the only one that understood her, he was the only one that knew where to look for her, and that was basically at her time machine. And this leads us to one of the most heartbreaking and gut-wrenching things we have to see this season. Lolly simply asks Healy if they went back in time in the time machine she made out of cardboard and aluminum foil. He says to her no. She replies, that's okay. And then she says, we'll just keep trying. The dialogue here is perfect, as you get a fleeting moment of lucidity as these characters finally come to realize the gravity of their situation and ultimately their fates. Lolly is whisked away to the psych ward, kicking and screaming the whole way, begging not to be sent there. Healy's reaction to this is absolutely unbelievable. There's very few actors that can pull off this range of raw emotions. He is literally physically convulsing at feelings of ineptitude, inadequacy, and the overall realization that the correction system simply isn't equipped to handle these kinds of inmates. Simply stated, if while you're witnessing all of this going down, if you're not holding back tears or at least have a ball in your throat, then you need to check your pulse or go to the morgue because you're freaking dead inside. Ultimately, a suicidal Healy has a breakdown and decides to check himself into a psychiatric hospital. Now, if you recall at the end of season 3, Sophia had a bit of a spat with Gloria and ultimately landed her in the shoe. Sophia is one of my favorite characters, and I hated that season 4 didn't have enough of her. But Jesus, when we finally saw her, she was almost unrecognizable. I thought they were introducing a new character coming out of Shu. And how badass is she? She's like freaking MacGyver. She takes a light bulb, breaks it, lights the mattress on fire to get her out of Shu. Now in reality, it was only a temporary relief from her confinement, but she did get Caputo's attention. And while we're on the subject, she's not the only one trying to get Caputo's attention. Sophia's ex-wife is practically stalking him. It got so bad that Caputo's new love interest actually had to pull a gun on her. Now, here's where Caputo's character actually takes a nice arc. You see, his girlfriend is part of the very corporation that is really killing the prison. She really comes to represent how quickly Caputo was seduced by false affirmation, faint praise, and incentivization. Thankfully, Caputo finally grows a pair of balls this season. He really has a crisis of conscience, and it's actually him that snapshots the photo of Sophia to leak to the media. It was that single act that got Sophia back into general population, and she inevitably reconnects with Gloria. And I gotta tell you, that reconciliation between Gloria and Sophia was simultaneously powerful and beautiful. Caputo was not the only one who was having a crisis of conscience this season. Luscek was also dealing with some very horrible demons for what he did to Nikki. And man, did he really go out on a limb for Nikki. I mean, he did some rancid ass stuff. I mean, I don't know too many men who would have a threesome with senior citizens just to clear their conscience. Yeah, that's right. We're talking about it. That threesome between Yoga Jones, Leszczyk, and Judy King. Now let's get real. What he did was to clear his own conscience, and it was more about making himself feel better. And in a really twisted, messed up way, it actually messed her up even more. It's so heartbreaking because on the inside, in maximum security, Nikki was actually clean. She was sober. She didn't even want to touch the stuff anymore. She had made some real progress. But sure enough, as soon as she hit general, she went right back on the sauce. It freaking sucks, man. You don't know how many times I caught myself saying, just under a whisper, "Come on, Nikki, please don't do it. Please don't do it." And speaking of all things that can completely fuck you up and backfire, oh my god, Piper. Now, as I mentioned before, there was a literal invasion of new inmates, and those new inmates that arrived came with the intention of starting a gang. It didn't help that the new CO, the captain of the guard, was a bit of an asshole. Actually, that's a bit of an understatement. And he really fostered this kind of race war. I mean, for God's sakes, they had inmates fighting each other like gladiators, just for shits and giggles. As it turns out, this season, Piper had a direct competitor for her smelly panties business. Having failed to charm the new CO, she took matters into her own hands, and Jesus, she totally went the wrong way about it. After very stupidly and very ill-advisedly trying to recreate the Third Reich in the prison, the Latina gang members threw a hood over her head, basically dragged her kicking and screaming, and branded her arm with a swastika. Okay guys, this leads us to the final major event this season. You knew this was coming. As you know, Suzanne, or Crazy Eyes, was one of the inmates that was forced to have those gladiatorial fights by the COs. If that wasn't bad enough, Suzanne was actually forced to fight her own girlfriend, and really bloodied her up. In one last act of solidarity, finally the prison comes together, and they kind of shed that whole race relations thing that they had the whole season. Now don't get me wrong, I'm making it sound a lot rosier than it actually happened, but the philosophy here was the enemy of my enemy is my friend, and the galvanizing event here was to stage a protest to try to get rid of the new captain of the guard. Now, when this conflict finally came to a head, Suzanne was in a very volatile state, and she actually was in the midst of a panic attack. When Jose stepped in to intervene and help out her friend, she was immediately pinned down by the new rookie CO. As a rookie CO and relatively untrained, he had put his full weight on the back of her neck, which impeded her ability to breathe. Very tragically, and much to the horror of the viewers, Jose died very quietly in front of everybody. Now here's where things get really interesting, and this is open for debate and discussion, and it's very controversial, but I'm going to give you my take on it and why Caputo did the things that he did from this point on. Now MCC was looking for a way to set up Jose, to make her look like she was not a model inmate, but when they couldn't, they had to have somebody to take the fall, so now they were looking at the new CO, the rookie. And this kind of shit happens all the time, this kind of character assassination where they look at the victim to see if they can demonize him. Clearly there are echoes of the Trayvon Martin shooting and what happened in Ferguson. So MCC was all set to let Bailey, the rookie CO, take the fall for Jose's death. But by this time Caputo had had enough, and rather than following the guideline from the corporation, he completely went off script at a press conference and decided to back the rookie CO. Now, many people interpreted what Caputo had done as a way of covering his own ass, but it was actually the opposite. What he wanted to do was expose some of the problems in the prison. Now, this of course didn't go well with anybody, and shit quickly spiraled out of control, which ultimately led to a riot. At this point, the prison was in total chaos, with the ladies just going nuts, running around and screaming Attica, even if most of them were too young to even know what the hell that meant. Now, the final scene in this season left us with a bit of a cliffhanger, which was pretty awesome. Fearing that there was going to be violence, one of the COs brought an illegal gun into the prison. Now, in the middle of all this violence with the riot, the gun got out of the CO's hands, and it was Daya that picked it up. We end with her telling the CO to get on the floor, or she was going to shoot him. Like I said, it was a really badass season, and shit got really dark. Come on guys, give me a little credit. Did you really think that I was going to end this episode on a bummer? Hell no. We're going to talk about Puze and her final episode. So really quick guys, I just gotta say, this was one of the most memorable and beautiful send-offs to any character that I've ever seen. It was really well done. In a glimpse of her backstory, we get to see a beautiful young woman, really in the prime of her life, and just exploring things. What made it so special is that she's kind of haphazardly traversing New York City, and just looking at the wonderment before her. What was really cool for me is when she eventually goes into that club that shows images of things to do to other people, like feed me, kiss me, hug me. That was freaking awesome, man. I also really liked when she ran into that monk troupe who were riding around Manhattan in their neon bicycles. That was really cool too. What made it more visceral, and I think it was done on purpose, was the fact that she comes to learn that they weren't monks at all, but they were part of a troupe that was actually doing a performance art throughout the entire Manhattan area. This window into Posey's life before being incarcerated really enforced the idea that she wasn't an average person. She was meant for something more, and she actually got more out of life than most people do in an entire lifetime. This was extremely comforting to me, and I'm sure it was to a lot of other viewers, as you slowly come to the realization that this person could never be constrained by the contrivances of life or society, even though, ironically, she was in a prison. In the very last scene with Posey, she almost conveys this to us as she breaks the fourth wall, looks over to the camera, and gives us that beautiful smile, as if to say, "It's okay, guys. I've transcended." Okay, I know that we've gone through a lot and we weren't able to touch on every single detail, but if there's anything that I left out that you feel was important, send me a message in the comments section and we can talk about it. Alright everybody, so that's my official spoiler talk on Season 4 of Orange is the New Black. As always, I thank you for tuning in and I'll see you on the next AGR's Pop Culture Reviews. One last thing, Posey, this one's for you.
A cop. And we went for it. I went for it. Treated him like a kid brother. And I was going to split 50-50 with a cop. Maybe they're waiting to put a medal on it.
Come on, get up. Get your hands up.
Yeah, that's it. A nice gold medal for the cop. Only maybe he's going to get it sooner than he thinks.
Yeah, yeah, oh.
Love my